Hello, everyone. Thank you, Ivan, for announcing my presentation. The idea is to give you the bioscience view, or my personal view on the future of agriculture, as the title is, or agriculture of the future. I don't know which one would be right. When we say agriculture, what is the thing that first comes to your mind? That's producing food, right? Producing food for people, for the global population, which is constantly growing. But to tell a little bit about the future and where we are going, we should go back shortly in the past to see just for the last 100 years how things were developing. So this is the Easter morning at the turn of the 19th to 20th century at the Fifth Avenue in New York. The first industrial revolution just ended, and all that you can see on the street are horses with carriages, which were mentioned before during the talks. What does this mean? The man's best friend at that time for any labor-intensive activity was horse. It has been used for basically everything, including the agriculture, especially hard work on the land. At those days, the press titles were telling that the new thing that happened, which is horseless carriage, and we can see one over there in the red circle, the horseless carriage is just a temporary invention, which is current fashion, is going to get out of the fashion quite soon. 13 years later, at the same place, the same day, just 13 years later, there are no horses. Actually, there is one over there, but you cannot see it. All that you can see are horseless carriages. At those times, the global population on the planet was just above 1 billion people. The revolution that the internal combustion engine brought to the industry reflected to agriculture as well. So just nearly after these cars, in some 1917 or something, the first machines like this, which we call them tractor, replaced the horse. And revolution in agriculture has started. What does that mean? How this reflects to the growth of human population globally? Well, the food industry has started to produce more and more food, and that's how we initiated the exponential growth in population. So for the whole lifetime of the human civilization, we reached 1 billion, and since those days up to now, we reached 7 billion. So it was exponential growth with two world wars, which reduced that a little bit. So it was the first revolution in agriculture, which really started a number of companies and brought new way of working in the field. The second one happened in the 60s and 70s, which we call the Green Revolution, where fertilizers and other chemicals came into scene. Whether it was good or not, we are facing now the consequences of that. But the point is that it really made the agriculture more and more efficient, and the yields were higher with less diseases and other pests that are related to agricultural production. What is interesting is that a number of now leading world companies, which are estimated at hundreds of billions of dollars, were made at that time. I won't give any names of them, but where we are going, in which direction we are going. We are now 7 billion, and by official estimates from United Nations, FAO, and other agencies, by 2050, which is quite soon, we're going to be 10 billion people on the planet, of global population. Or there are different ways to say that. One of them is that in the next 40 years, we have to produce more food than the entire human population produced since the beginning of the mankind. So how to do that? We need to feed the population. So that means that we have to increase the food by 70, food production by 70%. If we have the growing population, the trend of converting the agricultural land into urban areas will continue, which is kind of conflicting with what we want to achieve. So we have to really make sustainable, environmentally safe agricultural production to support the growing population. And we say that we cannot feed today's world with yesterday's agriculture, but highly productive, sustainable agriculture can feed a multiple of today's world population. So looking at that way, what did we say by now? We had mechanical engineering bringing one revolution, chemical engineering bringing another. And what's left now? What do we have that we still haven't exploited enough? And it's penetrating in all aspects of our life, but still not enough in food production. That's the information engineering. Information are all around us, but we just have to observe, to analyze them, to register them, and to understand what is really going on. So this is the one small chunk of the line of trees which stretches for 5 kilometers between Novi Sad and Belgrade, not far away from here. And if you take a look at that photo, you can see something that is interesting trend. Not everyone can notice that, but people who have the background in signal processing can easily notice that there is a waveform. You will not see any tree that is out of order. So you have the wave going up and down. If we look at the whole line of trees, look how it looks. So they were planted in the same day or same week. They had the same rain, same sun, same wind, but they're not the same. And they're different, but not like people. One is taller, one is shorter. No, they're in the waveform. And we can understand only one reason why that happens. There is a small change in soil, which we usually neglect in current agriculture or historically classical agriculture. And now we come to the point, something that we call today precision agriculture, where we want to observe this information, to understand what is really happening, to get to dig deep into the soil, to scan the soil, to get the shots from the satellite and to observe as much as we can to get the data in order to make the IT the backbone of the agriculture of the future. So what do we have now? This is the map of this province of Vojvodina, where we are now. But it's not just any map. It's a satellite view of the crop structure. So we, from this map, we can see what is grown where, in which field. If we take a closer look at the whole thing, here we are somewhere. This is the Mokrin, and this is here we are currently. And we can actually, by the technology that we have today, we can see what is just behind the other house, what is grown. So this is the corn map. On all these fields, we have the corn. This is the wheat, and this is the sunflower. So, and this is the information taken from the satellite from the last week. So they're constantly flying over us, and we can exploit this. But not only that, we can not only that we can answer what is grown where, we can also tell what is the shape, what is the healthiness of the plant. So, for example, this is something that we call near difference vegetation index, which gives us the photosynthetic activity of the plants, how good the plant is, and the greener the better. So, you can see where those are artificial structures like houses, but you can see in here that we have different shapes of the plants on the ground. So let's zoom a little bit on this field up there. And if we can, if we make another zoom, you can see the variation. Now, remember the trees, the waveforms. This is exactly why this is happening, because we have different phenomena on the soil. So you can also spot it here, that things are changing. And this is something that we want to exploit, to have the 1 meter precision in everything that we do. It's in seeding, in fertilizing, in irrigation, to optimize the resources and to go really in sustainable and highly efficient production of food. This is just one view of the things. How are we going to get there? Of course, to get all this information, we need a lot of information collecting devices that we call generally sensors. And we can do it manually now, but don't be surprised if in a few years from now you see these kinds of things, robots roaming around in the fields. Actually, it is estimated that robots are going to have exponential growth in ag tech sector, and that in 10 years from now, most of the machines in agriculture will be robots. In fact, if you go, all of us who came here, we were driving on the roads between the fields. You maybe notice some combine harvesters, tractors, and things like that. If you take a closer look, you will see that there is a driver, but he is playing Tetris. He's doing nothing. The combine or tractor is driving by itself through information technology, through GPS navigation, things like that. But soon we are going to lose the driver. So there will be no cabin, just a tractor. Actually, John Deere just released last year one of these. And where are we going? In which direction? In the information society, we are riding on the fourth industrial revolution, which is the IT penetrating everywhere. We are converting everything into data source. So machines, plants, animals, people, we are harvesting data in an opportunistic way in order to exploit them. So this is our vision of the agriculture of the future, where you can see animals, sensors in the ground, on the machines, you can see the combine harvesters, you can see the tractors, you can see drones, satellites, base stations for mobile phones that are collecting also information, and you can see the robots running around. Maybe a few people left, mostly coming here for, like we all came here just to observe things in a global village. But basically, all of us, we are all sources of information. We are producing some information that is collected into one place that we call popularly today cloud. And that's where the information engineering starts, where from all of these zeros and ones, we have to get the knowledge to understand really what is going on. And this is something that we call today, there are multiple names for that, machine learning, artificial intelligence, big data, call it however you like. The point is that we are collecting all the information and we can give the services to this guy.
Sorry?
To this guy here. This is not an ordinary farmer anymore. This is the farmer of the future who has the mobile phone, the tablet, and he is analyzing the information from through different services that he is getting. Actually, we are currently working on something that will be released in 2 weeks, 2 weeks from now, and you will all have a chance to see the new way of looking at digital agriculture. We call this digital agriculture, where everything is based on the information engineering. So, from all these ones and zeros, we are producing new knowledge and new services. The satellite images that I have shown you, they are made like this. We understood really what is growing in which field, and we gave it to the machine. Machine learned how to interpret the data and to provide new services for the farm. So, in Global village, connected world. This is what we see as the farmer of the future. The young guy that did his PhD somewhere else, United States or wherever, came back here to run the highly efficient agriculture. It's not far from now. We expect to see this just in a few years in the future. And interesting thing is that this is a very good opportunity for all the young people. When you say that somebody is working in agriculture, stereotype is that it's uneducated old man without teeth or something. Now this is good-looking guy that that is overlooking his robots running through the fields or managing the irrigation in a smart way. He's not only the consumer of the information, he's also producer of the information. His machines, plants, and everything is producing the information, and now the whole new view at the agriculture is open where the information is on the market. He can sell the information and get the, not only for the wheat or corn, get the money, but also for the information that he generated. Also, the IT is opening new ways of making virtual cooperatives to make to cut the food chains, to get the easier access from the field to the market, support organic production, and all the other things that we were talking about during the day. This is something that is in front of us that we say it's agriculture of the future or future of agriculture. So this is it. Thank you.